Until this moment, you probably never thought you'd be watching a video about the Comet 225, a boxy and clumsy late Soviet-era mini hi-fi system. It weighs almost 10 kilograms, or 20 pounds, and urban legends claim that it could survive falling from the third floor of a building. We'll come back to that later. The USSR spent most of the 20th century in self-isolation, but in its citizens' homes in general, you could see all the same things you would find in yours. Well, kind of the same, but also weirdly different. It's as if they came from a parallel civilization from another planet, and if you look closely, an inquisitive eye will reveal a few of that planet's secrets. Make yourself comfortable and prepare to discover the simple joys of human existence amid the ominous coming of communism.
Did you notice that loud clanking sound when I started the tape? If not, here it is once more.
What is this? Is this safe to put in the living room? Can I allow my kids to use it? Does it utilize parts from Kalashnikov's rifle? You'd be surprised how close to the truth the rumors about Soviet-era meat grinders slash machine guns actually are. This heavy tape recorder was born in Siberia, at the Novosibirsk Precision Engineering Plant. Under this vague name and nondescript signboard, the factory designed and produced laser proximity fuses, military-purpose magnetrons, and other terrifying items. As these large factory buildings were clearly visible from space and gained a lot of interest from the enemy's intelligence, it was a common practice to manufacture ordinary civil goods in such factories too, thus disguising the classified activities. For example, some factories, in addition to bullets and shells, fabricated enameled wash basins and glass jars. Others were more sophisticated, and so Novosibirsk became one of the few Soviet home magnetic recording R&D labs. All the engineers there worked side by side, which meant deadly weapons and radio cassettes were designed literally in neighboring offices. Casting and stamping workshops were shared by bombs and loudspeakers. The daily routine at the Novosibirsk Precision Engineering Plant is well known to us thanks to a retro electronics forum user who goes by the nickname Loganov, who colorfully described all the struggles and hardships a simple Soviet engineer had to overcome when working on a machine that plays music in a country that wanted to play superpower. Lagunov did his university graduate thesis on a magnetic modulator for lasers used in air-to-surface missiles, but then chose a modest path of designing peaceful products for ordinary people, for which each gram of gold and each transistor, worth a nickel each, had to be approved at the very top through the large chain of ministries, departments, and committees. Here is one of his stories. Compact cassette tape decks are surprisingly complicated machines. Each part is tiny, and the tape drive mechanism has to be made with incredible precision.
As wow and flutter distortion that appears if the tape speed is not kept constant can seriously hurt human ears.
For example, the out of roundness of the drive shaft should be less than 2 microns. And now imagine this, the great and terrible USSR, which built a nuclear and a hydrogen bomb, which launched a man into space, which could hit a fly on the other side of the globe with a rocket. That giant economic and military power could not manufacture a motor for a better than mediocre cassette tape deck. It just did not have equipment that was precise enough. Sure, the handyman could handicraft almost anything, and that was enough for the production of experimental superweapons, which were not required in large quantities. But no human could manufacture hundreds of thousands of tape deck motors manually. Up until the Japanese production line was bought and installed in Novosibirsk to serve the needs of the entire USSR, the motors for the few existing Soviet hi-fi tape decks were produced by laboratory assistants in scientific labs. And that was one of the reasons these decks were so rare and cost like half a car. For cheaper and more affordable music devices like our Comet, Siberian engineers had to find another solution. They used a large, powerful motor and a really massive flywheel, and let the power of inertia do its thing to keep the rotation speed constant. That's why this machine is so heavyweight, and that's why it rewinds tapes so fast and sometimes even tears them. But enough of the technical details. What music did people back then listen to? The Soviet Union had its own music industry, and like any other local music industry, it had its best songs of all time you've never heard, and its one-hit wonders. Really talented artists, but also propaganda singers. In the 80s, a substantial rock music movement was born, and it became a real underground music scene that entered a tough battle with communist ideology. The system responded with persecution and subjected musicians to compulsory psychiatric treatment. Other artists chose an easier route and just stole tunes from foreign bands, taking advantage of the country's cultural isolation. But the most attractive type of music for the young generation was, of course, Western music. As you can guess, back then it was impossible to just go into a record store and buy a freshly released Dark Side of the Moon album. The only existing state-owned stores only sold records produced by the sole operating state-owned record label, The Melody, and they only worked with government-approved Soviet and Eastern Bloc artists. Nevertheless, all the newest discs from the Western world quickly penetrated the country, crossing the Iron Curtain hidden inside briefcases of diplomatic staff, traveling workers, sailors, and flight attendants. On the black market, one such record could be worth 100 rubles, more than half of the average monthly salary at the time. Of course, very few could afford to purchase such expensive records for personal use. This was an investment. People bought these albums, recorded them on tapes, and then sold these tapes in the flea market, making the music available to everyone. Machines that were produced with the intention of distributing party leader speeches quickly got out of control, and the role of tape recorders, which played forbidden songs of love and freedom, in raising the generation which finally tore down that wall cannot be underestimated. Music was, and still is, a very powerful form of art, and the Soviet system had to come a long way from prison sentences for clandestine trade and prohibiting Pink Floyd for, quote, perversion of USSR foreign policy, to eventually accepting the reality, and even printing cutout cassette covers in a popular woman worker magazine. Here is one for the great Bon Jovi from the United States of America. The KGB is well aware you know a guy who will record them for you, and they just got tired of all this meaningless chase. Another method of obtaining precious foreign music was, oddly enough, the radio, with special programs like Record This on Your Recorders, which would stream a whole album by Queen or Uriah Heep at exactly 2:05 p.m. on Sunday. Between the news of another Soviet economy achievement and discussion on the pernicious influence of the West. This music was often played from the same pirated tapes provided by the private music enthusiasts. By the end of the 80s, The Melody themselves officially released a few bootleg vinyl compilations by popular Western pop and rock artists, and none of the major capitalist labels had any ability to sue them. Comets, too, only came on the scene by the end of the 80s when, along with Perestroika, a limited small business became legally allowed. Both ordinary people and first entrepreneurs highly appreciated Comets for their durability. Wear resistant sin dust head, it says proudly right on its body, as if bragging, and you got a regular perm alloy head that will wear off in a few years. You suck. Due to the lack of advertising, which was considered a pointless waste of resources by greedy capitalists trying to drown each other, this recorder needed to sell itself, and so it did, in a very formal and hard-to-read bureaucratic tone. Stereophonic Cassette Tape Deck Model 225. Tape Consumption Control, whatever that means, and Electronic Logic Control. While common middle-class American, European, or Japanese decks featured heavy levers you had to forcefully push in order to play or rewind the tape, the efficient Soviet economy could afford to put a whole circuit board of Soviet microchips, the largest microchips in the world, which controlled electromagnets that did all the lifting with the light touch of a button. Electronic logic control was an important feature for those pirating home studios, as now multiple tape recorders could be started simultaneously just by connecting their pause buttons with a wire. And almost every Soviet man had a soldering iron and knew where to put that wire. They had to, because like all other Soviet electronics, these machines had awful production quality and were sold right along with an electric circuit diagram for DIY repair. The popular Radio magazine, a meeting point for all electronics enthusiasts, was issued in huge numbers, and every month people shared their experience of improving their tape recorders. For example, by preventing them from making these awful loud explosion sounds when they were powered on, or by disabling the speakers when headphones were connected. Non-geeks also knew simple tricks for repairing a failed logic board. Generally speaking, these clanking heavy cubes served a good long service in apartments, at school dances, and at pirate music kiosks. A rather powerful sound amplifier, cooled by a huge radiator, which also played the role of a counterweight for a heavy motor, could pump the beautiful shiny speakers to their full volume. And very few knew that those speakers were manufactured by prisoners, forced into hard and poorly paid labor from dawn to dusk. Like human beings, tape recorders need something to eat. And just as the planned Soviet economy could not feed its people, so it could not produce cassettes, which had tremendously poor quality. They squeaked, lost recorded sound, and damaged the playback head. The same Radio magazine mentioned earlier published a hilarious correspondence between one of its readers and a chemical plant chief engineer. "Why," asks the reader, "does a Soviet cassette cost 4 rubles, while a Japanese cassette costs 25 rubles? "Well," answers the chief engineer, "abroad the price of a cassette varies from 30 cents to $17, and can even depend on the shop where you buy it. But in the USSR, the State Committee on Prices has set the price of a cassette at 4 rubles. "No," retorts the reader. "Everyone knows that a Japanese cassette is worth 6 times more, because it's 6 times better and will last 6 times longer." Then the chief engineer advises the reader on how he can improve his Soviet cassettes with his own hands. For example, by writing Side A or Side B on the cassette with a pen, as the factory sticker had all the information except the one bit of info that would actually be useful. "But wouldn't it be easier not to draw anything? Not to write anything? And finally, not to insert your cassette into the tape deck at all? And instead, sing everything that is recorded there by yourself?" Below this, the editor published official government statistics, according to which, by the year 1988, the USSR had produced 29 million cassette recorders and only 33 million cassettes. That was a great scientific plan for a next-generation economy free of all the horrors of capitalism, producing 1.13 cassettes per cassette deck. It is noteworthy that the engineer was surprised that abroad, the same product in different stores could have different prices. Because in Soviet Russia, all prices for all products were set by a special government institution and were not changed for decades. On many products, the price was even stamped, like on the back of the case of this 1990 unit. On the 1991 unit, when the monetary crisis and food shortages started collapsing the system, there is still a place for the price, but no price is stamped. And finally, on the 1992 unit, which was produced and sold after the transition to the market economy, there is no mention of the price at all. The transition to the market economy was difficult. Workers at the Novosibirsk Precision Engineering Plant received the ultimate redesigned model, which was now the Comet 226, as their salary, because the factory did not have any other means to pay them. The workers had to sell or exchange the Comet for food and clothes themselves. And that was not easy either, as with the raising of the Iron Curtain, the now ex-Soviet states joined the new global trend of made in China. Through the 90s, pop music killed grunge, CDs finished off vinyl and cassettes, and cheap plastic boomboxes pushed old heavy amplifiers and loudspeakers into dusty attics. Once daring and talented artists started singing pseudo-patriotic songs, praising the new young president of Russia, and almost all domestic production of anything was shut down. The Comet 225 did not survive falling from the third floor after all. It had cheap Gentinex printed circuit boards that failed even when trying to just unscrew them, and the rest of it was made from ordinary plastic. But the memories of the juicy analog bass and distorted cassette treble, the music that was hard to obtain but could carry you away to a different world, and the market where each product had a different face and, once bought, could serve you for decades, will forever remain with us. If you like this awkward Soviet guy, check out a video on his soulmate, the red angular-shaped tram, model name KTM5. And if you want to see another story on how things fell apart back then, watch our video on post-Soviet era public transportation. Thanks for joining Nostalgia on things you've probably never seen in your life, and hope you'll come to our channel again.